Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Let's pray before we take a seat. Father, we thank you for our service today. We thank you for the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, for everybody's heart to be open and receptive to the flow of the Spirit of God this morning. And we'll have eyes to see and ears to hear everything from your word that you need for us to glean from Scripture, to leave this service stronger in spirit than when we came today, and better equipped to do everything you ask of us in these last days. We thank you, Lord, once again for the freedom we have in America to gather together like this without the fear of arrest or persecution, as it is for so many people around the world. We thank you for this, and we don't take this for granted. But we once again offer to you our hearts in praise and worship and thanksgiving for the word that we explore this morning as led and guided by the Holy Spirit. We thank you for all of this, Lord. We do everything in your name, we pray. Everybody that agrees with that prayer said together, amen. Okay, everybody back up and park. And let's get into the word. First of all, let me just also follow up with Pastor Dan's comments about our relationship with The Rock. We have been in relationship with this church since the late 1980s. We first came into contact with Pastors Jim and Debbie way back when, and we have grown together over the years. And it's exciting always to see the growth here as well as what God is using us to do overseas. And it's important for you to understand how important you are to the success of our work over there. Pastors Luke and Stacy joined us last May for the youth conference. We do one every 3 years, and we had over 1,000 young people there having their lives turned upside down by the power of God and by the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And shortly after they left, we had 3 summer missions tours. We do these every year, and you're always invited to attend if you're so inclined. But we were able to lead over 6,200 people to Jesus in just a few days of ministry and outreach, 6,200 plus. Amen. And for those of you that need to come tonight for healing, let me also tell you that during those 3 mission tours, God anointed the people who came with us, and 2,213 people testified about an instant healing when we laid hands upon them in the name of Jesus. 2,213 people. So, the same Jesus that does that stuff over there is the same Jesus that's going to do that here tonight. Amen. So if you're in need of healing, or if you have friends that are in need of healing, you need to bring them tonight and expect God to be great, because he's well able to do whatever you need to have done in the name of Jesus. Can anyone say amen?
Amen.
All right, so we'll have a great time tonight rallying around the Word of God to receive the healing if we need it. Okay, how many have their Bibles or their Bible device, whichever you brought today? If you have either or, turn to Judges chapter 8, verse 21. We're going to start with the book of Judges. We're going to go through a few commentaries here, a few verses, and then we're going to end up in the Gospel of Luke, and we'll spend the remainder of our time there. But in Judges 8 and 21, now I'm reading from the New King James Translation, unless otherwise indicated. And in the 21st verse, we'll just read it, and then I'll comment upon what we read, all right? 21, so Zeba and Zalmunna said, "Rise yourself and kill us, for as a man is, so is his strength." So Gideon arose and killed Zeba and Zalmunna and took the crescent ornaments that were on their camels' necks. All right. To summarize what we just read, if you read Judges 6, 7, and 8 and get the context of what we just read, these two kings are captured enemy kings. They came against Gideon and his army, and you know the story about Gideon and his 300 men and all of this, and they were all slaughtered by the power of God. And now these two are the remaining elements of the invading army that have been captured and have been interrogated by Gideon, and they are about to be executed, okay? They are enemies, prisoners of war, and they're about to be executed. It says, in fact, in the 20th verse, Gideon told his son Jether to do the killing, and Jether, being a young boy, a young man at that time, was more or less intimidated by the situation, and he wouldn't do it. So Gideon got up and killed them. But before he executed these two captured kings, they made a statement. And it's important to understand and to realize that God uses whomever he wants to get the truth across to whomever needs to get it. You know, the Bible talks about talking donkeys, and the Bible talks about all kinds of things that God does out of the norm and out of the ordinary to convey truth to people when they need to know. And the Holy Spirit is allowing us and wanting us to see from this statement here, from these two condemned kings, something that you and I need today more than ever before. It is this statement where they say, just before they are executed, "Rise yourself and kill us, for as a man is, so is his strength." As a man is, not as a man's going to be someday, not as a man wants to be, as a man is, so is his strength. So your level of strength is connected directly to who you already are. So let me say it to you this way. You are who you can be. Let me repeat. You are who you can be, or you can be who you are, whichever way you want to look at it. But the point is, it's been my experience in traveling around the world for 36 years, worshiping and serving Jesus and preaching his word. Most Christians have no idea who they are. And as a result of the lack of information and that lack of awareness, they can never rise to their level of potential in Christ because they don't know what their level of strength is because they don't know who they are in Christ. I bet you passed 15 churches on your way to this one. Thank God for a church like this one where the leadership of this church teaches people who they are in Christ and what they can do because of who they are in Christ. We need to know these things, okay? As a man is, so is his strength. Your level of strength is directly connected to who you are and your awareness of who you are, okay? Now, it's important to understand this because now more than ever in these last days, we need to step up to the plate and represent Jesus accurately, not just with a lot of verses, but with verses combined with and followed up by and with the power of God to confirm the things we say. Are you listening? And the good news is anybody in this room can be used by God. You don't need to go to somebody's Bible school to get qualified to be meet for the master's use. Everybody is qualified because inside of us, according to 1 John 4:4, is the Holy Spirit, and greater is he in us than the devil who is in the world. Now, not someday, not someday when we get to heaven, not someday when we finish our Bible school classes and all of this and get our doctorate and our diploma and whatever. Right now, anybody in this room can be used, and God wants to use you. Can anybody say amen? All right, 1 Chronicles 28:10. Let's go to that passage. These are simple statements from the Word of God, too simple to misunderstand. And this one from 1 Chronicles 28:10 happens to be one of my favorites. This is a conversation between David and his son, Solomon. Shortly before David dies and goes on, he's passing on information and instructions to Solomon. And here's what he says. This is one of my favorite statements in all the Word. David says to Solomon, "Consider now, for the Lord has chosen you to build a house for the sanctuary. Be strong and do it." Notice, he's told to do something, to build something, to create something for the Lord, but he needs to be strong to finish the assignment. Okay? There is a principle revealed in this statement. It's a spiritual principle that transcends into the natural as well as prevailing in the spirit world. The stronger always prevail. It's just the way things are. The stronger always prevail over the weaker. No matter what you're talking about, in sports, in finance, you know, the people who have money, lord it over the people who don't. The people in sports that are more talented will win the games when the people who aren't don't. And I mean, it just on and on and on. But the point is, it's a spiritual principle that is revealed here when he's told to do something for the Lord and to be strong to finish whatever it is he's told to do, okay? Whether you know this or not, when you got saved, you were placed in construction. You're in the construction business. We are involved in the business of building the kingdom of God, of which this church is a part of the kingdom of God. Can anybody say amen? And you and I are part of that kingdom. We're part of that building process. Building by building, block by block, person by person, the body of Christ is being built all around the world, and we're a part of that. But we have to be strong to do whatever it is we're told to do. Loving the Lord is not enough. We can love the Lord all we want, but at the end of the day, you're going to need to know who you are to be as strong as you need to be to finish running the race, whatever the race may be that you're told to run. Finish it. Don't just start. God's not impressed with people who start. He's impressed with people who finish. I've been doing what I do for 36 years. I've watched them come and go on the cover of Charisma in the 80s and Ministries Today in the 90s, and you don't know who they are now, where they went. I don't know, but I'm going to finish my race. I'm going to cross that finish line, and I'm going to hear God say, well done, good and faithful servant. Amen. How about you? I want to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. I don't want to hear just, well, what happened to you? Disappeared for 30 years. You know, no, I don't want to hear that. Praise the Lord. Amen. I'm sure you don't either. All right. So let's go on over to Luke chapter 11. Let's talk a little bit about being who we are. You can be who you are. Just because you are in Christ doesn't mean you become the stronger person, the strong person you need to be. You need to know some things. And there's a passage in Luke chapter 11, beginning in the 14th verse, and we're going to read this, where the Holy Spirit shows us and reveals to us who we are and what we can do because of who we are. As a man is, so is his strength. So we're going to start reading in the 14th verse. Now, you read along with me. We're going to read to the end of verse 26, okay? And then we'll come back and take a look at what we have just read, okay? Luke 11 and the 14th verse. Here's what it says. And he, that would be Jesus, he is the Jesus here. Jesus was casting out a demon, and it was mute. And so it was that when the demon had gone out, that the mute spoke, and the multitudes marveled. But some of them said, well, he casts out demons by Beelzebub, the ruler of the demons. Others, testing him, sought from him a sign from heaven. But he, knowing their thoughts, said to them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and a house divided against a house falls. If Satan also is divided against himself, how will his kingdom stand? Because you say, I cast out demons by Beelzebub. And if I cast out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore they will be your judges. But if I cast out demons with the finger of God, surely the kingdom of God has come upon you. Let's keep reading. When a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace, his goods are in peace. But when a stronger than he comes upon him and overcomes him, he takes from him all of his armor in which he trusted and divides his spoils. He who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters. Verse 24, when an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places seeking rest and finding none, he says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes, he finds it swept and put in order. Then he goes and takes with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. Notice there's bookends here to this story. Verse 14 is the eviction of the demon spirit, the casting out of that spirit. And then in verses 24 through 26, we see that spirit coming back. Okay? In between those two things, Jesus reveals to the reader and to the listener back then, truths you and I need to know today about who we are and what we can do in Christ. Okay? And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to break this down into five distinct segments for you and for me to understand from the things we read. We need to know some things because as a man is, so is his strength. All right? As you are in Christ, you can be powerful, you can be used by God, but you need to know some things, and these verses will tell us about that as we read. First of all, beginning in the 14th verse, the first part of this little passage we read, imposing the will of God by force. Notice, the demon was cast out. He was not asked to leave. He was thrown out. We impose the will of God by force, my friends. The devil is not going to step aside and let us go do whatever we want to do for God just because we want to go do something for God. He is going to contest you every step of the way. The good news is he can't stop us. He'll try, but he can't stop us. The gates of hell, Jesus said, the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. And we're the church, okay? So let me ask you a question. Do you think, let me back up and rephrase, when Jesus cast that spirit out, do you think the spirit wanted to be cast out? No, he likes it there. He's got this person bound. He's enjoying the torment that he inflicts upon this poor soul. He has nowhere to go. He likes where he is. He's got this person bound. And, you know, does he want to leave? No. But he has to go. He was cast out. The word cast in the Greek there means to forcibly throw. Like, you know, when you go fishing, you cast that line out there. You throw that thing out there to catch fish. This is what we're talking about. It's like some intruder coming into your house, you know, and you catch them on the front porch and you throw them off the front porch like that. Oh, that's what the word cast. It's not, we're not asking for him to leave if he would like to. We're throwing him out whether he likes it or not. And this is the way we impose the will of God on earth today. We do it by force. We don't ask for permission to kick the devil around. We just kick the devil around because we can. Because we know who we are. And we know he can't stop us, even though he might like to. And we know he would. So, first of all, you need to understand that the kingdom is enforced by force. Okay, being strong enough to do what needs to be done. The demon didn't want to go, but he had to go because he knew who Jesus was and he knew who was backing Jesus, all of heaven and the power of God his Father. All right, Luke chapter 16, verse 16. Hold your place there in Luke 11, and just I'll let the people put that one up on the screen for us, the video crew. Luke 16, 16. It's a good verse, and it goes right along with what we're reading here from the 11th chapter, okay? This is what we see on the screens. This is from Luke 16, 16. The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time, the kingdom of God has been preached, and everyone is pressing into it. Pressing. Now, that word in the Greek, pressing, that means ramming, jamming, and cramming. Okay? Years ago, my wife and I were flying through Hong Kong on our way to the Philippines, either on our way to or from, I forget which. And we had to travel on an underground train from one terminal to another. And so we, you know, went down the escalator, got off the jet, went down the escalator to the train, and the doors, you know, slid open and everybody started to go in. But I noticed that there were uniformed personnel standing along the platform there where the train was, all neatly dressed, you know, nice red stripe down their pants, male and female, little hat on their heads, you know, and they all had white gloves on. And I thought to myself, that's odd. Why are they wearing white gloves? Well, I found out in just a minute. As we all got into the train to move from Terminal A to Terminal B, okay, what we in America would think is a full car, a full train load, they're just getting started. I have never seen so much humanity stuffed into one space in my life. I mean, the gloves were for pushing. I didn't realize this until they began ramming, jamming, and cramming as many human beings as they could into that train compartment. But that's what this verse here talks about, pressing into the kingdom, ramming, jamming, cramming. The devil is not going to just step aside and let us go do whatever we're going to do. We're going to have to force our way in, and we're going to have to force his way out. Kick him out in the name of Jesus. Throw him out. Throw him out of your marriage. Throw him out of your family. Throw him out of your business. Throw him out of your church. Throw him out. Don't be too kind about it when you do, because he hates your guts, and he'll kill you if he can. Return the favor. Praise the Lord. I hate him as much as I love God, and I let him know as often as I can. Second part to this little passage. There are only two kingdoms on earth. Notice, Jesus talked about kingdoms. He said, every kingdom divided against itself will fall. Every kingdom. Every kingdom includes the kingdom of God, if every means every. All right, every kingdom. There's only two. He talked about them in the passage. Go back and read it with me from Luke 11. You know, he says in the 17th verse, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and a house divided against a house falls. If Satan is divided against himself, how will his kingdom stand? So there's one kingdom. It's the kingdom of Satan. And then Jesus goes on. But, verse 20, if I cast out demons with the finger of God, surely the kingdom of God has come upon you. So there's only two kingdoms. Now, in the natural, there's many kingdoms. There's a cultural kingdom, there's a national kingdom, there's financial kingdoms, political kingdoms, all kinds of kingdoms in this natural world. But in the spirit world, there's only two. Kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness. That's it. And those two kingdoms govern everything else. Whatever's going on down here, it's a part of one of those two kingdoms, and those two kingdoms control everything. All right? Now, inside those two kingdoms, there are also groups of people. And in the kingdom of God, there are two distinct groups within the kingdom of God. And those two groups, it's very simple. It's not hard to understand. They who know who they are and they who don't. They who know their level of strength and their potential in Christ and they who don't. Two groups. Now, I'm well persuaded in my travels, the group that doesn't know who they are is much larger than the group that does. Like I said, you probably pass 15 to 20 churches to get here, and I would guarantee, I'd bet money that most of those churches don't know who they are, pastored by people who don't know who they are. That'd be, I'd bet money on it, okay? The point is, there are only two kingdoms, and you're a part of one or the other. You can't be simultaneously a part of both. Take your pick. You're going to be a part of the kingdom of darkness, or you're going to be a part of the kingdom of light. I know where I'm at. How about you? Amen. Only two kingdoms, only two groups inside each kingdom, they who know who they are and they who don't. And I'm well persuaded that you know who you are in Christ. And if you don't, hang around for a while, because this church will teach you and will tell you who you are. And you can live your life in the light of who you are. Okay? Instead of bumbling and mumbling and stumbling along claiming to be Christian. Who is really just an embarrassment to the body of Christ. Are you listening? Aren't you glad I'm not your pastor? Praise the Lord. All right. Then third part, moving right along. Luke 11, 22 and 21. I'm sorry, yeah, 21 and 22, should say. Luke 11, 21 and 22. All right, so the third part are spiritual identities confirmed or identified by comparison. He's going to compare people here, okay? He goes on in the 21st verse. He said, now he's talking about two different people. He was talking about two different kingdoms. Now he shifts gears, and he's talking about two different types of people. He says in verse 21, when a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace, his goods are in peace. But when a stronger than he comes upon him and overcomes him, he takes from him all of his armor in which he trusted and divides his spoils. Now, who are these people? Remember, if you study the Bible, read verses in context. You can't take verses out of context and make them say things they don't say. Because if you do, you're going to be in error very quickly. And many, many people are, because they pull verses out of context. All right? The scriptures were not originally written with chapter and verse markings. That stuff was added centuries later for research and reference purposes by people. All right? The verse markings, the chapter headings, are not anointed by God. Those things were added by men later. The scriptures are anointed, but not the verse and the chapter markings. Jesus never went down the road saying to his disciples, as an example, verily, verily, I say unto you, boys, chapter 9. Refer to verse 37. I'm about to teach you something here in this passage. No, he didn't talk that way. This is just one long, all, you know, anointed verbiage from Genesis to maps. Praise the Lord. All right. Two different kinds of peoples. A strong man and a stronger man. Now, in the context of what we're reading, what started this whole passage? Jesus casting a spirit out. Jesus throwing an evil spirit out from a poor soul who couldn't set themselves free. So, who's the strong man? According to the context, what we're reading, he is the devil. The strong man is the devil. He's fully armed. He guards his own palace. What's his palace? His kingdom. The kingdom of darkness. The one Jesus referred to just a minute before. And who are his goods? Or what are his goods? His goods are in peace. Who are they? Or what are they? The goods are the people he's got bound. His palace is protected. He's fully armed and his goods are in peace. The devil is bound people. They can't set themselves free. They're in jail. They don't know how to get themselves out. And he loves it. He likes it. His goods are in peace. Until the stronger man shows up. Who's the stronger man? That's us. We're the stronger man. Back then it was Jesus. Now we're the body of Christ. He's in heaven, but we're the body. We're the stronger man. And the strong man, his goods are in peace until the stronger man comes along and takes whatever he wants. Why? Because he can. Why? Because he's stronger. When I went to school in Ohio, I went to St. Clair's Elementary School, Mayfield Heights, Ohio. That's a suburb of Cleveland. And I went to St. Clair's. It was a Catholic school, and most of our teachers were nuns. And we had a few lay teachers, but most were nuns. Anyway, we had a recess time from noon until 1 every day. And so we would take our lunch to school. You know, back those days, you know, mom would stick some stuff into a lunch box and we'd take it to school. And then we'd have lunch from 12 to 12:20. And then from 12:20 to 1, we'd be sent out into the parking lot for recess to run around and, you know, kids running off the steam and all the energy. And then they'd bring us back into class for a couple more hours. And then by 3 o'clock, they'd send us home. Well, you know, I can distinctly remember at fourth, fifth grade-ish type, you know, that's where I was with this. You know, recess was supposed to be a happy time, you know, where kids run and jump and play and have a good time. Recess for me was a time of terror because, I don't know, maybe in your class you had people like this, but in my class we had several boys who should have been in the eighth grade and they were still in the fourth grade. For whatever reasons, they didn't move on with everybody else. And so I can distinctly remember one kid. His name was Ian. I don't remember his last name. But Ian took great pleasure in beating me up every day on the playground because he could. Because he was bigger than me, you know. And I knew it and he knew it. And I spent my recess time hiding behind the bushes, hoping that Ian wouldn't find me. But because whenever he did, he just took great pleasure in beating me up for 40 minutes. And that was my idea, that was his idea of recess. My idea was hiding and, you know, evade and maneuver and, you know, whatever. The point is he could do it because he could. We're the stronger man. Notice, when the stronger man comes upon the strong man, he overcomes him and takes. He doesn't ask for permission, he just takes what he wants. Takes from the strong man all of his armor in which he trusted and divides his spoils. That's us. We are the stronger man. We are the stronger woman of God. That's who we are. And you need to know that we can do whatever we need to do for God whenever we need to do it because we can. Greater is the Holy Spirit in us. Amen. And there's no expiration date on this power, friend, either. You know, you don't see on your Bible best until, you know, January 17, 2019. No. This stuff is real every single day. If you know who you are, and if you walk in the light of who you are, and if you talk like it, and act like it, and think like it. Amen. I don't tell, you know, the devil doesn't tell me what's going on. I tell him what's going on. He doesn't tell me what I'm going to do and don't do. I tell him what I'm going to go do, and I just let him do the backpedaling. Amen. And, you know, people get offended, you know, they get it. Well, listen, Jesus offended plenty of people. A lot of people got offended. And they're going to be offended when you act like a stronger man, talk like a stronger man. Amen? You know, hey, listen, we're going to heaven or hell. People are going to heaven or hell. You know, when you die, you're going up or down. That's it. This is not complicated, okay? If you accept Jesus, you're going to go up. If you don't, you're going to go down. You're going to go to hell. Well, I don't believe that. Well, go to hell. What can I do? Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Okay. All right. Look at Matthew chapter 11, verse 12. Matthew 11:12. Let's put that up on the screen, gentlemen, please. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it. Take it. Take it. Take it. By force. By force. By force. You know, we're not asking for permission to do the kingdom business. We're going to go do what we need to go do, and I don't care who likes it and who doesn't. I'm not out here to win a popularity contest. We're here to do a job for God. Amen. Some people will love us and a lot of people will hate us. So be it. At the end of the day, we're going to stand before the Lord. Really, your opinion of me doesn't count and my opinion of you doesn't count. It's God's opinion of all of us. That's the only one that counts. You know, I've shared this story at some place along the way here at some time. But anyway, there was this is an example of what I'm talking about. There was a crusade we did years ago in a city called General Santos early on in the early years before I had my own team with me that I trained and prepared. And so we were preaching in a situation and a setup much like what I see here. There was a platform up a little bit higher, steps on the side, and there was a crowd of about 300 people there in the middle of a park, the city park. And we were having an outdoor crusade, and it was a very successful event, you know. And in our meetings, we have a song service. We have singers and musicians who play and singers who sing to draw people. That's how we get them to come, and they do. And so, they're going through their part of the service on this particular day. And I'm sitting back here waiting to step up and preach and share the word with the people. So the singers finish and the musicians are done. So they all file off. And so we've got about 6 microphones here on the front, all of them unoccupied for a minute while I just collect my notes and step up to address people with the interpreter and whatever. Okay. So in the meantime, while I'm about ready to step up there, this witch doctor runs up on the stage. about 23, 24 years old would be my guess, a young lady, a witch doctor. And she starts putting spells on people, pointing her finger at people, putting spells on them, and calling rain down from the sky to try and destroy the meeting. And you talk about things like this in America, and people stare at you like you just got off the bus from Mars. But you know what? In the third world, this stuff is real, and they know it's real, and they start to scatter. Now, back then, our group, our team, was just a bunch of volunteers, and thank God for the volunteers, but because I didn't have a chance to brief them and to train them like I do with my own folks now, they didn't know what to do. They stood there with their, you know, mouth open, looking at me like, what are we supposed to do? We don't know what to do here. While she's, you know, putting spells on people. In my crusade, the audacity of this. And so, you know, the Lord said, do something about this now. This is not the time to go behind the statue and pray for 45 minutes in tongues waiting for a revelation from God. You better know some things about who you are before you get up there. So God said, do something about this now. So I said, okay. So I walked. She was facing the crowd. I came up from behind. She didn't see me. I grabbed her by her shoulders and spun her around so she's facing me. Picked her up by the front of her blouse. I took the microphone out of her hand first, spun her around facing me, picked her up by the front of her blouse, and threw her off the stage. To which people will say, well, that's not very spiritual. You're right. It isn't. But it was extremely effective. We never saw old Honey Buns again for the rest of the crusade. Praise the Lord. Gone. Just something about being thrown off a 5-foot stage that kind of conveys the message that you're not welcome here. Thank you, Father. All right. We don't ask, we command. We demand, we take. That's what we do for God. So that brings us now to the fourth part of this, and that's the 23rd verse. Back to Luke 11 we go. Luke 11, 23. Jesus makes this seemingly off-the-wall comment that doesn't look like it fits. But how many of you know, when you read, you know, chapter and verse and in context, everything fits, even if you don't think it fits or it doesn't look like it fits. All right? He made this statement in the 23rd verse, after he talks about the strong man and the stronger man, blah, blah, blah. Okay, he gets to verse 23. He who is not with me is against me, and he who doesn't gather with me scatters. Now, what's that mean? What's that got to do with what he's talking about here about strong men and stronger men and kingdoms and so forth? Listen, here's the message. If you don't know who you are, if you don't live and talk and think and act like the stronger man or woman of God that you already are, you are actually a spiritual liability, not an asset. So the fourth part is be an asset, not a liability. Don't be the name on the pastor's list of people that he needs to see today, and when he sees your name, he rolls his eyes and says, oh no, not them again. You know, the counseling session that never goes away. All right, the people who never grow up, the people who never get the binky out of their mouth and keep on just being the babe in Christ that they were when they first got saved, year after year after year after year. You know, it's okay to be a babe in Christ for a while, but you're supposed to grow up. You're supposed to take out the binky, pick up the weaponry, put it on, learn how to use it, get out there on the front lines and start shooting. Amen. Okay? Listen, if you're not with him, you're against him. If you're not an asset, you're a liability. You are the albatross on our back that we keep carrying along with us, the complainers, the mumblers, the grumblers, the ones that never can seem to find a place where they're happy in the body of Christ. Always something going on, always some crisis to deal with, always some counseling session to schedule. You know, let me tell you, in the Philippines, as Pastor Dan said, we have 200-plus churches, so I'm pastoring pastors. So my job is to encourage them to encourage the sheep. And a lot of times, this usually happens just once, it doesn't happen after this, but the first time they come in for help and counseling, they'll come in bemoaning their situation, how difficult and how terrible it is, and I'll say, stop. Listen, whoever told you ministry would be easy? Whoever told you pastoring would be easy? Whoever told you this? It didn't come from me. And if you're going to stay in this organization, you're going to have to suck it up and get your helmet back on, quit complaining. Listen. It's just so hard. All right, if it's just so hard for you, here's what we do. We pray. We believe that you die right here in my office. Go home to heaven. There'll be no more problems for you there. No more devil, no more demons, no more issues, no more sickness, no more nothing. You'll just be with the Lord and with the angels. You can run and jump and dance and clap and shout with the Lord while we just go on and do something for the Lord without you around. Go on. Be warm, be filled, and be gone. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. All right, time for time. We need to move on. Hallelujah. Shandai, see my bow tie. Praise the Lord. Okay, verse 24. This is the last part, part 5. This is the demon who comes back. This is the one that got cast out. When the unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places seeking rest. Finding none, he says, I will return to my house from which I came. When he comes, he finds it swept and put in order. Then he goes and takes 7 spirits more wicked than he, goes back in there, and the last state of that poor soul ends up being worse than it was at the beginning. Here's the 5th point. There's always going to be a counterattack. You need to be ready for this. The reason you need to become the stronger man, the stronger woman, is for your own soul's sake. Not just for the others out there, but you need to protect the turf that God gave you, called you. The devil's going to come back around. If you got set free from pornography, if you got set free from alcohol abuse, from drug abuse, from whatever abuse, you need to know those spirits that you threw out or someone cast out, they're going to come back around. Sooner or later, they're going to come back and knock on that door and see if they can get back in. I mean, listen, when you went to church today, you probably locked your house. And when you parked your car, you probably locked that car too. Why? Because there's thieves out there. People want to take what you own. And there's a thief called the devil, and he's going to take what you have if you let him. When these demons come back, Jesus says the house is swept and put in order. The kitchen sink is arranged. The furniture is all neat and tidy. They vacuumed. It's a nice house. But the front door is open. So, listen, if you go to church today and you got your house all clean, you cut the grass yesterday, and it looks great, and you leave for church and leave the front door open, and then you come back from church and all your goods are gone, whose fault is that? Someone will say, well, why didn't you lock the door? See, listen, you need to understand the devil's going to come back around. So you need to know there's a counterattack coming. Be ready for it. Read and feed and go to church and be in these church services all the time. Listen to these pastors. Listen to these people talk. They know what they're talking about. So that you can adequately defend yourself when you are attacked in return. Because the devil's not happy about the fact you threw him out. He's going to come back around. So, point being, you can be who you are. Let's say it that way. You can be who you are in Christ, but it's your choice. I've chosen, praise God. How about you? Amen. I'm going to be who I am, and I'm going to be what I can be. Praise the Lord. And I pray that you will be too. Did this help anybody today? Amen. All right. Bow your heads, close your eyes. Let's take care of kingdom business. We don't do services around here without giving people a chance to receive Jesus. I never do a service without doing so. And so here we are. This is the most important part of a service. Please don't move around, okay? Let's be reverent for the Holy Spirit. I don't know who you are. I don't know if you're a member of this church, and I don't know what your spiritual condition is, but God does, okay? You're not fooling him. Maybe you're fooling us. Maybe you're fooling your family and your friends, but you're not fooling God. He knows what's going on in your life. He knows your thinking. He knows your motives. He knows everything. He knows where you go. He knows what you do in the dark. He knows it all. So please, like I said earlier in the message, you're going to go up or you're going to go down when you die. We're all going to go either up or down. And if you die and you start to go down, you cannot reverse direction. Let me repeat. If you start to go down after your death, you can't reverse direction. Choice is a weapon that we've been given in this world. Free will is a weapon Satan cannot breach. You can choose Jesus. You can choose to turn your life around. You can do that now. But when death comes, the power of choice is removed from you. Everybody in hell, I mean everybody in hell, if they had one more chance to accept Jesus, hell would be emptied. There'd be nobody there. Everybody would accept him if they could, but they can't. And they'll never get that chance. They'll never get that chance ever, ever, ever again. So here's your opportunity. I'm going to count to 3. This is how I do it overseas. This is how we do it here. When I count to 3 and I reach 3 and you hear me say 3, put your hand up high so I can see it. Don't try to inch it up and hope I don't see. Put it up there. Be bold about the fact I'm going to serve Jesus. I'm turning my life around. I am tired of being beat up all the time. I'm going to be the tormentor instead of being the tormented. That's me. That's what I'm going to do today. I'm turning my life around. All right? Because death comes to people at unexpected times, friend. You might be dead before the sun goes down today. You don't know. People are one heart attack away, one car crash away, one tragedy away from eternity. And most of those people who die and leave aren't prepared, aren't ready to meet Jesus. And they start to descend, and they'll never get a chance again after that. So here it is. Here's your chance. Don't sit there thinking, well, I'll do this someday. Someday may never come, friend. Right now, here's your opportunity. Take advantage of it. I'm going to count to three, and then you put that hand up. Don't be shy about it. Be bold. We'll clap. We'll salute you. We'll be glad for you. Okay? We won't embarrass you. God knows what's going on in your life. The only one you're fooling is you. The only one you're fooling is you. Don't let the devil make a mockery of you anymore. Choose Jesus. Choose life right now. All right? It's not a feeling. It's a choice. Choose. Feelings come, feelings go. This is a choice forever. All right? One, two, three. Put that hand up if I'm talking to you. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. I'm looking around. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Praise the Lord. Many hands. Would you please stand up? Let everybody stand. You've been sitting for a little while. And if your hand went up and I even saw it or missed it, it doesn't matter. God sees it. I want you to come down to the front. Make your way down to the front for just a minute, please. Your friends will wait for you. Okay? Come on down to the front, please. Let me shake your hand. Come on down here. Come on down. You put your hand up, come on down. Okay? Come on down here. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Come on down. Don't be shy. Make your way on down. Come on. Glory to God. Amen. Come on down, folks. You put your hand up. Come on down here. Thank you, Lord. Be bold. Amen. Wow, anyone else? There were more hands that went up. Maybe you're nervous. That's all right. It's okay. God still loves you. And we love you too. This is wonderful. I want you to know, everybody standing here, how precious this is to God, what's happening right now. All of heaven is rejoicing for what you're doing here. And this church was built just for you. All that we do here is for you. All of it, everything, all the departments, all the activity is for moments just like this, okay? You may not fully understand what's going on, but we are here with trained people to help you understand the magnitude of this moment in your life. This is the most important moment of your life. Nothing is more important than this, okay? So what I want you to do, I want you to trust us for a few minutes. I want you to go with this gentleman right here, Pastor Joel. Go with him for just a minute. Let him talk to you. Let him pray with you for a minute. And then you come back and meet your loved ones, and on your way you'll go, okay? Because you need to know some things about what's happening and what this means for you, okay? So if you'll turn this way to, there we go, right there. Follow him. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Hallelujah.